Bonjour, Lausanne. One of the pieces of evidence that the gospel is advancing and reaching the ends of the world is when we see bodies of believers who are able to worship Jesus Christ using their own languages and cultures. And the key factor in order for that to happen is when we allow God's word to dwell into their own languages and cultures so that they can experience God's full purposes. In 1999, Wycliffe and Esalen International realized that at the prevailing pace of Bible translation, it will take until the year 2150 for the last people group on earth to have God's word in their own language. That was a shocking realization that caused them to launch Vision 2025, which aimed to see a Bible translation program in progress by the year 2025. At the time, there were about 3,000 languages without any scriptures. And since then, so much has happened. At the last 2010 Lausanne gathering in Cape Town, we launched the call for the eradication of Bible poverty. And just in the past 14 years, we can see the tremendous progress that has happened in terms of the languages that henceforth has to have a full Bible or a New Testament or just some portions of scriptures. And for the first time in the history of Bible translation, we now have a bit less than 1,000 people groups around the world which are still waiting for some scriptures in their own language. This is history making. So several factors have contributed to this reality. One is the call for the eradication of Bible poverty as launched in 2010, which really spurred many agencies to consider Bible translation afresh. And we have organizations like Youth with a Mission, a Crew, Samaritan's Purse, Calvary Ministries in Nigeria, and so on, that henceforth embraced Bible translation as a core part of their ministry. Another factor has been the rise of the synergy called Every Tribe, Every Nation. That went a long way to bring ministry investors and Bible agencies to build the complementarity that allowed them to move faster than ever in their history. And another factor, as you can imagine, has simply been the rise of technology and the role that the global church continues to play as it takes more involvement and ownership into this ministry. This is to say that we live in an era where God is doing a new thing in the field of Bible translation, and the phenomenal growth of the church in the Southern Hemisphere is resulting in the gradual rise of an indigenous movement of God's people who are seeking to advance God's kingdom in new ways. Let me take Africa as a case in point. I can note four increases that are happening in Africa as it comes to involvement, especially in the field of translation. One is the increasing workforce, where just over the past 10, 15 years in the organization that I'm part of, we have seen a decrease of 20% of foreign workers, but an increase of 70% of indigenous workers. This is remarkable. And this is against the global trend where in 1970, 88% of the workforce in Africa came from the West, whereas only today we have 53% against 47% rising from within the continent. Another area of increase is in the agency in Bible translation. We continue to see Africa grow in the capacity of the organizations, United Bible Societies, Wycliffe Global Alliance, SIL, seeking to develop indigenous workers who are equipped with the confidence, the technical know-how in order to be able to undertake the whole task of Bible translation. not to mention the area of leadership, where we see Africa continuing to contribute thought leadership to the work of Bible translation worldwide. And today, for the first time in history, four key Bible agencies, SIL International, United Bible Societies, Wycliffe Global Alliance, The Word for the World, have all of their leadership stemming from the continent of Africa. And the last factor I want to mention here, where we see another increase, is in the area of what we see to be the African church direct involvement and ownership of the Ministry of Bible Translation. And we've seen churches in Ethiopia, in Sudan, in Madagascar, in Cameroon, all over the place. We see churches taking direct responsibility, moving from the places where they have only been the recipient of the work in the past to a new place where they want to take responsibility. And to give you an example, just a few years ago, the FJKM Church in Madagascar realized that discipleship was not going deep when they simply relied on the national Malagasy language to reach out to the people. Then they decided to translate the Bible into the languages of Madagascar so that the people could be reached in a more intimate way. And this is what the pastor who approached SIL to seek help said. He said, "We want to take care of our nation from within. We want to take care of our nation from within. We would like to have the word of God in all the languages of Madagascar, not in 25 years, but now." And that church went on to mobilize about 300 volunteers to mobilize finances and everything in order to start Bible translation. And just in 5 years, four New Testaments have been completed and four others are on the way because of this involvement and engagement of the church. This is to say that God is definitely doing something in this day and age. And the church of God, the church as it grows in the global south, is making a contribution to the advance of his kingdom. So as I move and to conclude, it is my observation that Africa is, as we look at consider the dynamics of how God is working in the world today, it is my observation that Africa is positioning itself to be able to fulfill its prophetic role within the global mission sphere in the 21st century and in the field of Bible translation in particular. And Bible translation is gradually becoming an expression of the ministry of the church as it seeks to reach out to the people and grow them as disciples. There are indeed many challenges and a long way to go to see the productivity in Bible translation match the theological formation and the impact that we desire to see in the whole life of the nations. But that notwithstanding, we see the fulfillment of what the father of the independence of the Ghanaian nation once said. And Ephraim Amu, because that was his name, once said this, that the foreign mission is not a permanent institution. It will pass away, but the church remains. So sometime sooner or later, there will come to existence the Church of Africa, a church growing in the knowledge of the Bible, a church producing devout men and women, bringing their minds to bear upon the great truths of the Bible, thereby making it a richer book. I have no doubt that we have entered that time in this 21st century, not only in Africa, but all across the global South. And this is not something, a matter of something for anybody to be triumphant about. It is the Lord's doing. And we have to return all the glory and the praise to Him alone. Thank you.